Right, so that should be us live now. As I was saying to the guys, I'm just going to introduce the kind of panel before we jump into anything, and then we can have a little bit of a discussion of the topic before we get into our kind of books and stuff. So welcome everybody who is watching, if you're kind of watching live or if you're watching it back later. I'd love for your comments below or in the chat as we kind of go through. So as the panel today, I've got, if I'm going to point the right direction, I've got For the Love of Comics to my sort of right. I've had him on a few times, so it's good to have you back.
Thank you. It's great to be back.
And then below we've got Comics versus the World or Richard. I knew you used Richard long before you were using the Comics versus the World kind of side of things on Instagram. Do you do anything on any other platforms? Is Instagram your main kind of thing?
Just Instagram. I was following a few of you people on YouTube before I set up my Instagram. So yeah, I was just Richard. And then started up the Instagram nearly 2 years ago now, I think. Just that Comics versus the World. I do have a Facebook page as well, but it's just a repeat of everything that's on Instagram. So
Cool. I have linked it down below. I got it wrong the first time. I put comic versus world and ended up getting somebody else. So I have fixed it. Make sure it's comic versus the world if anyone's looking
yeah,
for it.
there's a Comics versus World. There's a Cosmic versus the World, which is a slight just typo.
Oh.
Yeah.
So how's it going in general? You know, I see you've got a lot of kind of stuff moving around and stuff. Your house, are you just moving in, or what was the
We moved. I mean, I'm a bit lost for time at the moment, but it's about 2 months ago we moved into this house. But then, 4 weeks after that, we had a baby. So this room is actually the main living room of the house, but we're not using it at the moment. It's just a garage, effectively, because we moved from a house that had a garage into a house that didn't have a garage. So yeah, this is just storage for now, and then we're living in sort of like the back half of the house. But yeah, I've got my computer set up here that I work from home, so. Yeah, unfortunately, it also means I've got nowhere to put my books. So they are not on shelves. They're all in boxes, until we get all this sorted and get some shelving in. So that did limit my choices a little bit today because it was based on I went through sort of my CLZ to see what I thought. Oh, that's a good option. That's a good option. But then, could I find it? Was the next part. So yeah.
Did you? I'm just curious, did you use CLZ for moving and like labeling? Because I know that feature is there, but it just seems like so much work.
No. I just do that. I started using CLZ because I collect Legion of Superheroes single issues, and there's a lot of them. So I started using that just so that if I was a shop or a Comic Con, I could like pick books out and then have a look to see if I had it or not. But then after a while, I just started adding all of my trades and graphic novels to it as well.
Right.
I've just got everything on there.
Yeah, no, they've got a lot of ways to tag stuff. And one of those is like by carton or crate if you're moving. And I'd
Right.
read online of like people, like depending on what they're putting into which box, they just tag that on the, so later you know where things are in the boxes. And I'm just like, that's that sounds interesting as a result, but it sounds like a lot of work to get it done.
Yeah, I mean, I just sort of the boxes are just labeled like miscellaneous hardback graphic novels or.
Oh, well, okay. That's pretty specific though. That's good. I mean, it's a little bit much to put Dark Horse, you know, when you're moving all your furniture and stuff. You're like, no, I'm gonna have it by publisher, honey.
But like, not too bad. I can pretty much get to everything. The only problem is that as I'm buying things and reading them, I've got nowhere to put them. So I've just got a pile in my wardrobe. One pile that's stuff that I've bought in, and
And Triple
then
G's nice as
next
well.
pile is stuff that I've read but can't put away anywhere. So yeah,
Well,
we'll get there.
great to see
Did
everyone in
you
the comments.
have the shelves from the previous setup then, or are they all gone?
Yeah, I have a 4x4 Kallax and just a 2x2 Kallax, but they're currently used both for toy storage for the kids
Okay.
now. So they've swapped purpose. The idea of this room is it's going to be a slightly more grown-up living room. All the family areas out the back, and we're just going to have it's going to be a study / library, you know, the TV in it and some sofas. But it's going to take us a while to get there.
Yeah, and that's kind of how my living space is a little bit. It's almost like kind of split in the middle, where I've got a kind of corner sofa on one side with the sort of TV, and there's like a rug between the two. And then I've got the other side, the room has like a 5x5 Kallax, a DVD rack, and a somewhat just standard shelving unit the other side. That's like the doorway side of the room. And that's where I do all my videos and stuff, just in that sort of side of the room. But all of what would be like man cave stored stuff is all there. This room is literally just a tiny box bedroom that I'm using as a computer space.
Have you seen those couches where the sides of the couches, the ones that face outside, are bookshelves? I'm thinking that's the direction for me to go in once, you know, all the space is now literally gone. Just like until someone invents the ceiling bookshelf, until that happens, we're going to have to find bookshelves within existing furniture.
Well, that was going to be my next thing anyway. If I do expand, is I in the space I have, the only two spaces I have is either replacing small tables at the side of my sofa, which would become bookshelves rather than tables.
Right.
And the other option is to put stuff behind my sort of television, because the way my television is, I've got a, like, low board that sits maybe about 2 feet from the wall, and all the cabling and stuff just kind of sits behind there. If I tidied up the cabling, I could totally put a relatively thin bookshelf in there behind the TV.
Problems.
That would just be using every corner of space.
Waste not, want not.
But if it works at the end of the day, you know, it depends on what you want. I'm getting to that point where, you know, I've been selling a lot of books as I kind of buy books in. I'm always kind of, you know, rotating my collection.
Yeah. But
the more I do that, the more books stay. You know, so the percentage that I'm clearing out is getting less each time I buy in things. Because you might buy in like 10 books and get rid of 8, and then you buy another 10 books and you get rid of 8, and you're keeping 2 each time. So, you know, at a certain point, you know, I need more shelf space. I'm not going to infinitely be able to rotate the same space that I've had. And up until now, I've made that space up by selling like computer games or figures or other things that were taking up that space. But it's going to get to a point, you know?
Well, so, unless you start selling 10 and buying 2.
Yeah, it's not happening.
Sure.
Yeah, I just can't be as ruthless as you are, G. I don't keep things that I really dislike, but stuff that just isn't for me, I still put it on the shelf because I kind of think, my long-term aim, you know, it's not just my collection that I'm sticking on the shelves, you know, be able to share them with people. And just because I've got a volume 1 of I Hate Fairyland, which I know most people really love that, but I just didn't like it. Mm. I've kept it because I like Scotty Young's work and his art, and I know other people will like it. So if someone asks for a recommendation, I can go, here you go, and please keep it.
Yeah, I mean, if you're going to give books away, that's, you know, that's another way to do it. You don't have to kind of sell them. And the whole thing for me was just being open with how I, you know, somewhat fund my collection and free up the space. You know, I don't see many other people talking about it. And to be honest, I felt it was quite a negative, down kind of topic to bring up to begin with, because nobody wants to talk about getting rid of their stuff. But I got a really positive reaction, and people wanted to know more about different things you could do or not do. And like, so I just do it all the time now. I'm always thinking about what I can kind of clear out or not, as the case may be. But I see it as that. Like, I'm not selling a book as like, oh, I want to make £100 on this book because, you know, it's now going out of print or something. I'm doing it because maybe I don't like it that much and maybe somebody else will enjoy it. So why have it on my shelf when someone else could be enjoying it?
It's a healthy thing to share and show people that how you can do it, I think. Because, I mean, you've probably seen as well, people who just buy in book after book and they stay in the cellophane, and then they go, well, actually, I ain't got any money left pay bills. So I'm just going to sell 10 books that I've just bought, have sat on the shelf for a year and not done anything. And then 2 years later, they buy the book back again. I've seen that a few times. And so just curating and buying naturally the books that you want to have on your shelves and getting rid of the ones you don't need at the time.
Yeah. I think it also depends on just how, and I'm going to say the word wrong, but frivolous you like make your purchases. Like if you're the kind of person that buys like a book because you've been really hyped behind it, you really love this writer, the next volume's coming out, you know, even if it's like, okay, you're probably going to keep it, like your, you know, movie collection of your favorite like movie director or something like that. But if you went and bought 15, you know, Marvel omnibuses because they all came out this month, just because they all came out this month, the odds are you're not going to enjoy them all. The odds are you're not going to love them all. So, okay, still, you know, buy them, give them a go, but only keep the ones that actually kind of mean something to you or you kind of connect with. And sometimes for me, it's even just, I don't want to read it again and again and again. So like I've read the book maybe partly in singles. I then read it through in trades. I then bought it in omnibus and I've read it through in the omnibus. I know I'm one of the few people that actually has read like 99% of my collection. Like I read everything, even if I buy it in different versions. And once I've gone through that third read of something, I'm like, am I really going to come back to this in a year or so? Probably not, especially if it's something like a DC New 52 omnibus and we're now two eras on from then. Like there's no odds, of, you know, unless it's a really good run, I'm not going to come back to it. So, yeah, I mean, I found it quite difficult to begin with, but once I got rid of the few and never worried about ever coming back to them or picking them up again, I just continued. If I'd sold a few and I was like, oh, I need to go buy this again, that'd maybe do it slightly differently. But yeah, I think it's always interesting.
Yeah, I think I'm quite good at knowing what I'm going to enjoy. I don't just buy anything because people have said it's good. I can generally tell that I'm gonna enjoy a book, or at least I have an interest in that book because it's, you know, yeah, by one of my favorite creators. So it's very, very rare that I buy something that I don't like at all.
What is your general, I mean, I know you show a variety of stuff kind of on Instagram and stuff. What is your main area that you do enjoy within kind of books? Is it just a range across the board? Because I mean, I've heard you mention anything from like some of the sort of standalone kind of prose written kind of graphic novels all the way through to like Marvel and DC. Like, is there a preference you have?
No, I mean, I've been reading lately less superhero stuff, Marvel and DC, but saying that, somewhere in this room there is I think like 220 volumes of that Marvel graphic novel collection and I think 120 volumes of the DC one, the Eagle Moss one. So and I've read every single one of those.
Oh, those joining spine books, you mean?
Yeah. And I've never had a shelf long enough to be able to put all those next to each other and see the big picture. For quite a few years, I was just superheroes, and then would occasionally just pick up other sort of more independent stuff. I really like a little bit of everything, whether it's sci-fi or all ages or slice of life stuff.
I think is the question better the other way? Is there anything you avoid or you don't particularly like in comics?
I mean, horror's not really my genre, but saying that, there are a few that I really like. You know, like Gideon Falls, Crimson Cage, the wrestling horror one. Yeah. So there are the odd few I like. So it's not just I don't rule out a genre completely. But if I was going to say one, that's probably not my area.
Yeah, I think it's interesting because like for me, comics opened up me to a lot more genres than I probably would have in any other medium. And I don't really know why. Like if I watch movies, I maybe go to certain actors or certain studios that I like certain things of. And the same would have happened for novels or computer games or anything kind of like that. Whereas with comics, I think maybe because I follow creators and the creators can jump genres, like I just end up reading some things that I would never have, you know, dreamed of. Like I wouldn't have picked up Nailbiter as a movie. you know, but I read the whole thing and then I ended up buying hardcovers of the comics. So it's weird for me, like sometimes what it's kind of allowed, but it's all been good. You know, I'm always kind of looking for new or different kind of things. And one thing I want to kind of step into is actually language stuff. So like I did a little bit of German at school and I'd love to pick up some comics in German to actually start reading that more again. But not only that, because some of the European prints actually get bigger, larger kind of formats as well. So you're potentially going to get a nicer version of the book in the German or French version than you're going to get in the English version. So again, it's just something that I would never have done in movies. I'm not going to start watching a bunch of movies in German, but it's something that I'm open to in comics.
Yeah. I've started following, like, sometimes, I mean, I think we all follow certain creators, but occasionally publishers as well. So Avery Hill here in the UK is a small publisher. I often like things that they put out, and I've just got a few. So then one in the stack here to show is an Avery Hill one. And No Brow as well. I tend to post quite a lot of their stuff on Instagram. And I'll just try something just because the art looks nice, or even just the cover looks nice. But I know it's that publisher, and I think I haven't gone wrong with them yet. So, you know, give it a go.
You can get quality, especially from like specific imprints within publishers, if you know they're curated. I found that with Vertigo, a lot of the Vertigo stuff, I can buy really old random titles that say Vertigo on them, and like 90% of them will still be a pretty good story because they've been vetted by that team. I was going to just move on to the topic itself, but now just so we can have a little bit of discussion around that. So the topic I've put up is, you know, fun, short kind of comic books. And you guys came back and asked me a few questions about what that kind of means, because you had some longer maybe ideas and stuff like that. I'm not meaning that it has to necessarily be, you know, a short kind of comic strip or anything kind of as kind of concise as that. I was just really meaning, kind of like a lot of these things, the reasons I'm putting the caveats in there is to stop the, you know, the extremities rather than to control what you guys do within the kind of topic itself. So I'm not looking for like a 15 volume run or four compendiums or something like that, but you could quite easily do something that's like two or three tape paperbacks if you wanted, because that's still a fairly short run within things, within the books that do longer runs. But just as easily you could have something that's literally a comic strip. So some of the stuff I threw on the background are things like, you know, Tintin's an ongoing series, but you could read one of his books as a standalone short story. You know, Banana Man next to him is literally comic strips, or like one, two pages, depending on what you can read him in. And then you've got a few other ones. I've got like The Order of the Stick and some other bits and pieces kind of stuck around the background, and just little things that might be sort of shorter ideas. So that was my kind of thoughts going in. What were your guys' thoughts when I gave you the kind of topic as a whole?
I mean, yeah, I did think we could like overanalyze it and think, well, what is fun and what is short? I think the short means in different things. Again, thinking of different publishers, like short in a sort of a Marvel or DC sense, I think sort of three trades for me would count as a short run. Like the most recent, that Black Widow run, that was that Kelly Thompson, and that was three trades, 15 issues, I think. That to me is quite short. Fun, I mean, that could mean anything to anybody. Like, you could still have fun reading a horror comic, I suppose, but do you count that? I suppose what it means to you. I did try and mine are sort of more light, I suppose. So fun in the terms of it's just a nice, easy read. There's not too much to really think about. I'm saying that, but there isn't one of them. But something that's easy to get into and doesn't take a long time.
It'd be really insightful to someone if they were to bring up like three really dark horror books as their fun topic.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, for me, I was exactly what Richard just described. I was like, I'm going to analyze this. What exactly does short mean? And what exactly does fun mean? And then honestly, you know, I was just like, all right, I guess I've got a list of 10. So there are going to be some honorable mentions and there are going to be some reasons why they're disqualified and why they would have made it if I was using a certain definition, but won't under this other definition. And it's not a joke. That's the way I was approaching it. And I was like, that's probably a little too much for what Highland G was looking for. So, I mean, one of the things that happened is that I went to some of my shelves and I was just like, wow, I have a lot of sad books. It's just like, I don't think I can, that won't count or it'll be exactly that. I'll be judged. Like, how is this fun? And it's just like, well, I enjoyed reading these books. I think they're marvelous. You know, I think there was a question over here. There was a question over here. You know, if we remember something after we've read it twice or three times, and we're really not going to remember it again, or we're not going to come back to it again, what's the point of keeping it? You know, and I think that's one of those eternal questions. It's like, why do I keep books? So I can go to them when someone brings up a category like this, and then go, which one is it? Well, that's one of the reasons. But yeah, I think it's an interesting question. So what I was also thinking about with short is that, oh, it's very easy to classify short. Fun is the harder thing to think about. So short, one volume, but then, okay, you can have an omnibus, it can get really huge, but okay, something like one volume. And then I was like, I don't think that's all the way correct, because short can also be something that read really fast. So it doesn't matter that it's four volumes or five volumes. It felt short. It took less time, or it, not even in hours, it could have taken less time to read, you know, these six volumes than it took you to read one trade paperback of something more dense and heavy. But also the way that we feel inside our heads when we read, like it felt like less time. It felt like, what, it's already over? That sense of shortness, I think, is also very interesting, because that shows a particular kind of talent of velocity, you know. And so fun and short were equally complicated for me. So at the end, I also, I think, went the same way, is I tried to think of something that wasn't incredibly draining emotionally, would be one of the things I leave out. And then I would be like, well, and I have all these honorable mentions because I thought of all these books, and then I was like, well, that's a little dark, or, you know, that doesn't have a happy ending, so to speak. And, you know, that thing happens in that comic. So what, it can't really be fun if that happens. But so I did veer myself towards light, but I also wanted to have something meaty. Like, I didn't want to think about fun, because I don't know how other people are, but I often hear people say, oh, that's just for fun. You know, why think about it so much? You know, or that's a turn your brain off sort of movie. And I never quite understand what that means, because I've been very, very entertained by things that really are very smart, and being silly or being absurd doesn't mean you're not being smart. You know, so I think fun often gets correlated with dumb. And that's something that I really wish to reject, you know, as far as I can. I'm like, fun does not have to be dumb. It does not have to be low IQ. It does not have to be lowest, you know, playing to the peanut gallery, as they say. It doesn't have to be mean. It doesn't have to be cheap. So that's why I wanted to make sure that while I kept myself in the light side of things, I didn't want to talk about things that would be maybe, in my opinion, more close to dumb fun than just fun, if that makes sense.
Yeah.
Not that there's anything wrong with dumb fun, but I didn't want the word fun to stand for dumb. I want it to be dumb fun as a term.
Yeah, I mean, I was seeing fun as enjoyable rather than dumbed down. Definitely was more my kind of thoughts.
Yeah, but I mean, like, again, because different people interpret things differently, and they, you know, so the idea is, like, I was thinking about any book I thought of or selected, and I was like, well, someone could say that's not fun because, and then I'm like, what is the objection? What's the objection to using the word fun to describe this book? I guess is the way I was thinking about it, which might, you know, make more sense when we start talking about the books themselves.
Yeah. So that that's the general kind of topic for everyone, as I said, and that's kind of our kind of thoughts going into it. So as I said, I always love to have a little bit of the kind of discussion around the topic itself first, just to get an idea of where people are kind of coming from and kind of what that's kind of inspiring kind of book wise. As I said, I put some pictures around the background and stuff on the thumbnail. They're not necessarily the books that we're going to discuss, but it was just things to kind of prompt that kind of idea and tone of what I was kind of thinking. And I'm going to just switch the banner across to recommending books. And what I'll do is I'll kind of make each one of us bigger when we're kind of going through a kind of book. And we'll just kind of go around one at a time.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Does anybody want to go first? It's got a book you want to show?
I think Richard should go first since it's his first time on.
Okay. I'll start at the top.
Plus, he told us before this thing started that he's got 50 comics selected, right? So
I don't. It's not that bad, because this first one is actually four books in one. So this is one I've just been reading recently. I didn't say this live. I said it to you backstage, didn't I? A lot of what I brought is based on what fit the topic, but also what could I find? Because as you can tell from the boxes behind me, we've recently moved house. All of my books are still in boxes, not on shelves. So that did narrow down my selection. And this is a series I've just been reading. And before I get started, just to address what Lee said about a lot of us readers remember most of the details, I have a terrible, terrible memory. So I will try and give you as good a summary of these books as I can. But a lot of the reason why I hold on to books and don't bother selling them is because 6 months' time, I will have forgotten that book. And so I can read it again pretty much fresh and enjoy it again. So
yeah. I wouldn't say I remember all the details in every book. I understand, I remember the overall, maybe overarching story, maybe key moments that stood out to me. But if I waited 6 months between reading a book, I'm reading the book fresh. Like,
Yeah, my brain doesn't work that way. it just doesn't. So I brought, first off, the Izmir series. So this is from Avery Hill Publishing. A little publisher in the UK. Writer artist is B. Muir. And it's there's four in the series so far, so that's the first one. Second one, Terrible Means. I'm not very good at getting this camera right. You can tell I've not practiced this.
It's because it's reversed.
Yeah, I'm going over here. The Tower in the Sea. And then Methods of Dying. So they're all quite... have I got that in my order now? Yeah. So they're all quite thin, just short. They're smaller than a normal trade paperback. And it's all like watercolour over line art. You can see that, okay.
Oh, yeah.
Let's see if I can find a splash page or anything, but I can't. But you get the idea. And it's all anthropomorphic animals. And it's a bit of a mystery in this city of Izmir. You've got something going on that you don't really, it's the first book. If you just read the first book and do not continue, then you're kind of left thinking, what have I just read? I don't really understand what happened. But the series like drip feeds you bits of information in each book that you then piece together as to what's going on in this world. And it's full of magic. There's something going on with the government, and there's some anarchists that are setting off sort of plant and flower explosions, and you have no idea why, and you still don't by the end of the first book. But then as you go into the second book, it sort of says, oh, well, this is happening, and this is, you know, potentially killing off the planet. So that's what these anarchists are trying to sort of rebel against. And then in the next book, you go you go visit them while these people studying magic, where they're studying and how they're learning, and then how they find out about what's happening. And then in the last book kind of jumps slightly, and it's just like a little murder mystery that's set in the world and is loosely attached to it, but it doesn't necessarily fill in that much more information. But it's just like a little short story that's set in the world. After the first one, I wasn't 100% sure, but I really enjoyed the art. So I thought, and then to be honest, Avery Hill emailed me with a discount code. So I was like, well, all right, I'll just get the other ones. Fairly cheap. The price is $8.99 on each of them. And they do have them on Amazon. But yeah, once I then started going into the second and in the third and in the fourth, I was like, okay, yeah, I really like how this is told. It's not something I've experienced before, a story like it. Again, just a bit more of the... I can't get this. There we go.
Wow.
Yeah, it's...
So is it complete at the end of the four volumes?
I don't think so. Because the fourth one came out only 2021. So I think he's still planning on doing more. So I say he, I don't know. They're still planning on doing more.
Does it just come out as graphic, like as trades, or is it single?
Yeah,
well?
Yeah, they're just released in these small, slim volumes. So this first one was... 2017. Yeah, it's described as a fantasy mystery story. Okay. I'll read the back of the first one just to give you a better idea than my terrible summary. So the first one says, in the city of Izmir, Ed the sculptor works as his widower neighbor sings strange melodies late into the night. Meanwhile, across the city, a government building explodes into a mess of plants and flowers, and Bimyo's enchanting story of mystery and fantasy begins. So again, that really tells you nothing. Like, it is very, it just lets you discover what's going on as you go, I think. I really enjoyed it. And there's not a lot of text in them. There's quite a few pages where it's just somebody walking from one house to the next. I mean, there's a lot of conversations, but it's very quiet and very easy to read. And I had fun with it.
Fair enough. It sounds a little bit more like obscure. It's not like focused on like having like a specific kind of story as such. It reminds me of, I think I read a book a while ago called Prison Break or Prison Breaker or something like that. And it was basically about people that were like stolen from one planet and put on another, and then they were used to sort of colonize a certain sort of plant or something that only their people could make. But most of the story was just left to the art, and it was very, you know, obscure and sci-fi and very interesting, but didn't necessarily, like, it was more about exploring the art and exploring the world than it was about each individual person's story or something like that kind of thing.
Yeah.
That's the kind of impression I got.
Yeah, because you sort of, the character you follow in the first book, if I'm remembering this right, you don't then see him again in the second, third, or fourth volume. He's just sort of a conduit for you learning about the story in the first volume, or sort of getting into this mystery. And then the second volume is a prequel. So you learn a bit more about this mystery from there on.
Sorry, what is the tower in the sea the second volume, or the?
I think Terrible Means is Terrible the second Means. One. That was 2018 that came out. Yeah, and then the tower in the sea is the third one. So, that's in the right order. So, yeah,
and it's supposed to be read all together, or can you just pick up one and read it? That's too many questions.
It's
Were you trying to find out how fun it is, are you?
Because the first, like I said, the first one, I think you could just read it. As long as you're not someone who needs a definite answer as to what's going on.
Yeah, I just find it interesting that they've not numbered it like 1 to 4. They've kind of given them names, which would indicate their separate arcs that you can
themselves. I literally went by the year that it was published and went in that order. But they are published just with names. It's not like Terrible Means is mere volume 2, Terrible Means. It's just Terrible Means. So you could easily pick that up in a shop and not have a clue it was part of anything. And I think you could start there because this one's a prequel. That's the second volume. And then if you went on to the third volume, I think that would, again, then sort of make sense to you.
Yeah, kind of just follow through without And so what was the publisher one, again? Publisher again.
Avery Hill.
Avery Hill.
And then the fourth one is sort of like a standalone mystery, but it is tied into the world and you'd get more out of it if you've read the other ones. Okay. Yeah, Avery Hill, they've done a few Tilly Walden books.
Yeah. Those are the only Avery Hill books I've been able to get my hands on over here, but I've seen that they've got an extensive list of new indie creators. And they seem to be publishing all the time.
They did Zoe Thorogood's The Impending Blindness of Billy Scott, which is really good.
Right. I've got all those on my Christmas list, her books, because I haven't read them yet, but I keep getting recommendations. So I'm like, please, someone buy me the three of those books.
Her newest one's gone out of print as soon as it came, like a week after it came out. I haven't picked that up yet. But anyway, they're doing a second print run of that before Christmas. Who was the other one? Rachel Smith is someone who publishes a few at Avery Hill. She's a cartoonist that I follow as well. They've got a lot of good stuff on there.
That's good.
And they do often do sales. This particular one, they just emailed me and said, spend over £20 and get £10 off, which was just a ridiculously good deal. So I did that.
Yeah.
And they often do signed editions and book plates and things like that. So it's a good one.
That's cool. Do you want to go next for the comics, or do you want me to?
All right, I can just give you one of my honorable mentions that I thought I would have also in honor of Richard joining us today. So there's obviously Scott Pilgrim, which is 6 volumes, but is, I think, one of those things where you can zip through those 6 volumes very quickly. In fact, I had to wait for subsequent volumes to come out when I was reading this, and it was very, very difficult to be just because they were so effervescent. But they're all pretty good standalone, and you know, there's the versus the world. I think, you know, I mean, of course, there are the hardcover color editions out there as well, which I think are pretty good. There's one of those editions that I always talk about that has changed my mind, or at least made me think twice about recoloring or coloring of things that were black and white. It's just a horrible idea. That's one of those examples where it's an exception. But yeah, in these original formats resembling, you know, most of all manga, but the story feels like video games. It's propulsive. It's fun. It's really, sympathetic characters, but I also think it's pretty meaty, but it doesn't hit you over the head with stuff. It plays it so fast and loose with its metaphors and things like that I think Scott Pilgrim is just, it's a great read. It's a lot of fun. It can have layers for it. And I've never... I think because it was something I enjoyed so much that much later I became aware of some sort of, like a lashback at it or negative commentary about hipsters backlash. And stuff. And maybe backlash, I think. Was there backlash against it? I mean, I don't know if it's backlash as in eventually there were some opinions around that were quite strongly presented about how it's kind of a flimsy comic or how the characters are unlikable. And I never really quite understood that. I thought the characters were very likable in spite of being very flawed. And I thought that was kind of one of the parts of the story that I enjoyed.
Some things that get that big are always going to have some people that, you know, have a problem with certain things. Like Walking Dead is one I hear about that a lot, where there's about maybe 50% of people I talk to that are like, read every issue to the very end, it's awesome. And then I get other people that are like, this halfway point, it just starts repeating itself, I'm bored, stop, kind of thing. And like,
sure, but I mean, it depends on what the criticism audiences is. If the criticism is that I didn't like it, that's fine. You know, that is an opinion everyone can have. But if you, you know, it reminds me of something
but
that
most people won't say they don't like it. They'll say the thing's bad.
That's nebulous again. If someone says it's you know, I don't know. It's this is what I think. There was once I read about Nick Hornby talking about Bruce Springsteen, and there where he says, I can understand if someone says Bruce Springsteen is bombastic. What I don't understand is when they say he's jingoistic or macho. So it depends on what criticism you're giving. You know, he says, like, this is something that intelligence should be able to see whether it's true or not. The other is an opinion that you have of a particular thing. And one thing I can see and one thing I can't see. I think that's the part that I don't, you know, when people talk about it's not funny, I'm like, fine, okay, it may not be funny, but it's not effervescent, or the fact that it is kind of like when people say it's about nerds, I don't understand if we read the same comic, you know, I don't understand, because they're all like, they're dating multiple people at the same time and are in bands and stuff. I mean, like, they don't sound like nerds. They, you know, I mean, so I think that's the kind of stuff that I think is more a reaction to an image or a reaction to love or a reaction to other people's reactions than an actual reading of the thing itself, which I find even today, if I reread it, you know, I read it a long time ago, but even when I reread it, I find it to be equally entertaining, equally charming, and very, very fast moving. You know, I think it tries a lot of stuff. Some of it doesn't work, but then you just move on to the next thing. And that's what I really like about it. And I think in the later volumes, it gets pretty good as far as the characterization is concerned. But when I first read Scott Pilgrim, in fact, talk about reading out of order, I ordered volume one and volume two, and volume two got to me first and volume one was delayed. And this is back in the days when I used to buy one or two comics a month, or, you know, whatever I could afford was just one or two comics. So I read it. I read the second volume before I got the first volume, and I had a good time with it, even though I hadn't read the first book. And there are a couple of references in here that were quite cheeky, where they were like, who's that? He's like, oh, he was there in the first book. You should read that. It's really good. And the characters say this to each other a couple of times. And I thought, this is really cool that I'm reading this before the first book. And they keep telling me maybe the first book wasn't as popular, or maybe it became more popular or something like that. But the way that it's in the script from the very second volume, that you probably missed the first book. And it wasn't because I wasn't following it, it's just because the mail was late. But it worked really well for my perspective as well. But yeah, that's my pick, Scott Pilgrim.
The only criticism I've heard of it recently was just about some of the languages that may be a little bit outdated now. A couple of the terms that they use, but I've not heard anybody. I mean, Scott is really unlikable, but in a sort of charming way. But like, he's not, and it's okay to write comics about unlikable people anyway. I mean, I don't buy that as a reason that a comic isn't good, that the character isn't likable, as long as it's an interesting unlikable or someone who redeems themselves.
If they're meant to be unlikable, that's the whole point in the story. Yeah. If you don't like them, they've achieved their goal. Like, I don't know.
Well, I think if you say everyone is unlikable, or I found no one likable in it, I think what that's speaking to is relatability, because no matter what you want to follow people for whatever reason. So if they're not likable, they should be interesting, I guess, you know, or they should be dangerous, something like that, something that makes you want to follow them. And so, yeah, if someone says, I didn't find anyone likable in it and they were all very unlikable, I'm not able to excavate the reasons why, other than they represent some other real life people I know and I don't like those real life people, which I think is a funny way to look at art.
Yeah, I mean, I've never read it, so I can't really comment on how good or bad it is. It's always something that I keep meaning to pick up, and I was considering.
Yeah, I think it's color editions. I think it's great, and I think Rich, you like Scott Pilgrim, I'm gathering.
Yes, yeah, I'm a fan. Yeah, it's one of the few comics that my wife has read as well. She reads the occasional thing, and so it's both of our one of our favorites. And our baby girl is now called Ramona. So
oh, well, there you go.
So definitely a favorite then. But yeah, I find the language thing interesting because, like, I don't know, like personally, I read a book or watch a movie or whatever it is in its world of its time, and I don't try to put like my standards or the current time on whatever I'm reading. So I find it quite strange when people like go back to something like, say, 100 Bullets, and they're like, the language is a bit weird and wouldn't be accepted today. And I'm like, but it's not based today, so just read it for what it is.
I think there's
like,
two
if you
different...
don't like that language, if you're offended by it, fine, step away. But otherwise, like, I don't understand how it makes it a bad book by it being a dated book. Like, that just means it was written before now.
Yeah, I think it's as long as people just know going into... I mean, it's one of those things we used, you know, when I was at school, we used insults for people that we shouldn't have been using, and then as you get older we learned that, and you know,
but that's the thing, I don't want to shield it from that. I want that to be in my stories. I want to see all these offensive people in my stories because they exist in the real world as much as all the happy, you know, nice hero type people. You want to see all the negative type people.
Well, I mean, if you're saying like, that something is being hidden, that's a different matter from something being dated, right? They're two different things. I mean, one is like, if there's stuff in the real world today and someone doesn't want to put it in a book, I mean, first of all, that's their choice. You know, you don't have to represent everything, and every story can represent what. But I think the dated part of it, or the putting in things that make it of its time, I think Richie was saying there are two types. I would probably say there are seven types. Yeah. But
No. I mean, I meant either you're writing in modern day trying to represent what was being said in a different time.
That's that, yeah.
Or you're actually writing in that, you're reading something that was actually written in that time. It doesn't make either of them, it doesn't make whatever language it is necessarily right in either, but it's up to you as the reader whether you sort of accept it because, you know, it was of that time.
I just think if say in a story based in, I don't know, war times, you've got, you know, let's just say the Ku Klux Klan going about, and they would have said X, Y, and Z, you know, slangs, which would have been accepted in their little group and things within that kind of time. It would have still been offensive at that time, but not maybe as offensive as maybe they're considered now. Would it be like outright racism? I think if you take those phrases off of those characters when you're telling those stories, they're no longer those characters. They're no longer those bitter people of those time with those phrases because...
See, I think the difference here is you're telling a story. But you're telling a story. You're making a choice at a different time, in a different location, with a different background to tell a story. Why you're using the word isn't why they were using the word. You're using the word for storytelling, correct? For entertainment, for whatever. Now, your responsibility becomes what is being questioned. It's not a question of, you're not making a documentary and you're not presenting videotape or audio tape of that time. You are writing a story. You are making choices of what you're putting in there. And you're putting those reasons in. We've seen movies that are PG-13 and we've seen movies that are R-rated. We've seen movies that will show you flesh and will not. They make their choices of what they will show and why they won't. And the reasons why they do it are the ones I think that people criticize. People criticize 100 Bullets making something look cool and making something look sexy, not making something look ugly or dirty, but making it look alluring by making you think this is what machismo is, or this is what a certain, sure, it's a group of people, but it's all about the vocabulary and the way it presents things. And of course, that's where we get into the tough thing of what was the intention and what did people do with it? And when people criticize it, they're often criticizing as much what people did with it as the thing itself, sometimes even more. But then that's why the questions keep coming up about critiquing things and how they do things, whether they do things responsibly or whether they do things non-responsibly. You can have someone use language in a movie and it comes across as powerful and dramatic because it feels authentic. And you can have someone else use it for titillating purposes, for entertainment purposes, for a cheap and a very quick piece of, you know, entertainment without any depth to it. And one will be good and the other will not be good. And I think that's why it's important not to classify on absolute level that it should never be used or it should be used. But the question is, if you want to use it, if you want to use it, think close and hard about why you want to use it. I think that's the argument that's presented in the criticisms. But that's different from the dated kind of thing, which I think, again, is two different things.
Yeah.
It's like, the language of its time, the language of its time is dated. Well, sure, if it's trying to represent that time authentically. But if it's trying to be universal, if I watch a DreamWorks movie from the early 90s and I'm watching sharks swim around making pop cultural references that are just so old now that it doesn't have anything, it doesn't have any substance, it doesn't have any lasting power, that joke was a joke for 6 months and the movie is supposed to last forever. And so now you're not telling people about the time that this joke was made, you just made a joke that isn't understandable by anyone 6 months later. And that's a flaw in writing, is the way that it's presented. That's a cheap, again, it's a cheap, quick thing that doesn't have substance behind it.
And I guess for me, it depends on if it's an individual moment or if it's a characterization. Like for me, if it's part of your character through and through, through every interaction that they kind of have, and that is that character in that time, then it will be there through every moment, and therefore you're not using it for one laugh or for one dark moment or whatever.
Sure. But that's what readers and critics are doing. That's what they're engaging in. Was it cheap? Was it not cheap? Was it worth it? Was it not worth it? Because it isn't, that character isn't a living, breathing human being. That character is a creation of someone, and they put all of their scenes and all of their words in there. So what they're critiquing is the choices made by the creators, and whether they came across properly or they seem heavy-handed or they seem cheap or they seem lascivious or they seem meaningful and weighty. That is for the readers to decide.
Yeah, and I guess the biggest thing is just to rate it appropriately and be open about what's in your book. You know, then it's down to the reader.
Sure, but I mean, again, I don't think everything has to be, should it exist or should it be banned? You know, I don't think that's what it is. The thing is, yeah, it exists, but that doesn't mean it's impervious to people talking about it. I don't, you know, there's a difference between someone saying 100 Bullets is bad writing and saying 100 Bullets should never be published, should never be sold, and no one should ever read it. I think there's a very big difference between those two things. So I don't think people having opinions or criticizing something is the same thing as banning it, as saying it should never exist. They're just saying, you have the power to publish it, I have the power to review it. That's the trade.
I've just never personally got to a point with a book where I've found that anything has stood out enough to annoy me enough to, you know, to say something like, you know, about the language or anything like that. Like, I've always just read the book for what it is.
Well, I mean, yeah, it depends on opinions, but why am I on the big screen? Can we go back to where all three of us were equitably distributed? I feel a little self-conscious. Thank you.
I want to point out that we've been talking for 10 minutes on this topic. It's supposed to be fun, short comics. And
we go. This is how we stay on topic.
Scott Pilgrim, was that technically just an honorable mention, or was that natural choice?
Yeah, it's kind of an honorable mention because it is six volumes, but I did want to, you know, I wanted to say hi to Rich.
Thank you.
Right. Well, I'll jump onto mine so we can get moving on a little bit then. So the first one I want to show, which is the one I've got on the thumbnail I've mentioned a few times now, is Primer. It's one of my favorite sort of short books that I've found in the last sort of year or so. And I actually just found out recently that she's making a sequel to it. So there's going to be a sequel involving the Teen Titans, I believe, because this is published by DC. But basically, Primer is this young girl who is sort of failing in the adoption system, trying to get a kind of new parents, and just doesn't sort of feel any kind of acceptance. She finally finds parents that she clicks with that are a little bit kind of quirky. And through one of those parents who works in like a science government kind of agency, she finds this suitcase that has these paints in it, which can give her various kind of powers. She basically steals it, and the story kind of goes on from there. But it's a little digest book, and the art is almost like sort of Disney style sort of animation. It's really emotive. And there's loads of sort of really fun sort of hero moments where like she goes like gigantic or can kind of fly and kind of stuff like that. And one of the first things that stood out to me is it's like a really early moment where she like catches an airplane or something, and there's this really big guy at the airport, and she just turns around to him and says something along the lines of, "You two can be as strong as a little girl." So it's basically just a hero origin story. It's I thought it was a one and done kind of thing. So she goes from, you know, not being adopted to being adopted to finding these powers to sort of becoming a hero. And as I say, I believe the second volume is going to be some sort of crossover with the Teen Titans. But it's just a really fun, short one book. And I say that the story is complete in this, so you don't necessarily need to read on if you don't want to.
Yeah, there's quite a lot of those DC Digest sort of size, sort of all ages books that get really good reviews. I mean, there's some that don't get as good reviews, obviously, but there's quite a few. And I keep meaning to check them out, but I've just never picked one up.
Yeah, I mean, the thing for me that put me off most of the other ones is that they're tweaks of existing characters. So they'll have like, you know, I don't know, Batman, Catwoman, and the Joker in high school or something. And they'll have just like made up some random story kind of around it. Some of them are good, some of them are bad, as you say. But the cool thing with this one is it's a completely new character by those creators within their own little world or story. So there's nothing being changed here. It's completely fresh. So any kids coming in, if they enjoy this and they buy the next volume, you know, this story continues. It's not like if they go and buy a Batman book, it's going to be a completely different story than what they got in the digest. So I think that's quite cool if she keeps this going.
Yeah, you think she'll get pulled into the larger DC universe, and in 10 years' time she'll be part of the Justice League?
Well, yeah, I wouldn't be surprised, because I said she's a really fun little character.
Probably dying. I wasn't
a huge fan of the costume at the very end of it, though. She basically gets this kind of plain greyish costume that she's kind of given. So I'm hoping they maybe change that up over time, because it's just not as funky as her with all her bright coloured hair and stuff. And the various other outfits she has throughout. But yeah, as I said, I thought it was quite a fun book. It's quite female empowering as well. There's the story, kind of the mum of the kind of family is the one who kind of earns more into science and stuff. The dad's a little bit quirky and into art. And like I said, it's not in your face, but it does, you know, kind of attack some of those things that are avoided in other stories.
Yeah.
So yeah, that
sounds good.
Great.
Are we just going to quick fire around so we don't spend forever on them?
Yeah.
All right. So it's Richard again.
Yeah. I'll go with. Now, so this is one that I read a while ago, and I meant to, what I was going to do is reread it before the show, so I knew what I was talking about. I didn't have time. So I'll try my best. This one's called The Suitcase by Dan Berry. This was actually, I bought this from a charity shop for probably £1, I don't know. But it actually has like, it's got a little sketch and a signature in it as well, which,
wow.
So that was just a really good charity shop find.
Nice.
So I'm going to read the back again, because I think my summary is terrible. So I'm going to read the back and then I'll show you some art. It says, Helen is house sitting for her neighbors when the family dog suddenly dies. Unable to drive, and with the Top Gear fan next door neighbor offering no help whatsoever, she's faced with a major problem. How on earth will she get Crunch's body across town for the vet to take care of? And then she thinks of a red wheelie suitcase and forms a plan. What could go wrong? So it's a really silly, silly sort of story. And that is literally what the story is about. But it was just a lot of fun, and it is a really short. Here's what the art looks like. It's very much just slice of life with these sort of slightly eccentric characters. And it's just this really short snapshot of you know, something that could really happen to anybody. You're house sitting for someone and their dog dies. And then, you know, so she ends up sticking this dead dog in a suitcase to wheel it across town to take to the vet. And then obviously the suitcase gets stolen, and it's just like sort of silly hijinks taking over the course of like 1 hour of this lady's day, really. And it has a start, it has an end. Nice. It's just a really slim hardcover. Slightly oversized, so it's bigger than a normal trade. The price on the back is $8.99, and it's from Blank Slate Books, which is not one I know. Yeah. But I haven't picked up anything else by Dan Berry, but he's had a couple of different things out recently, and I wish I could remember the names of them. And he's someone I want to try other things from, because it really does have a really good dark sense of humor. But it's so quick to read. And just, this is really just silly fun. But with good characters that you can sort of, just get on board with. I really enjoyed it.
What was fun to see me find in a chat shop? Sorry.
Yeah. No, I was just wondering, the colors, are they watercolors or pencils or what does it look like?
Watercolor. If I show you the end pages, you can kind of probably see a little bit better on the end pages. If you can see on those trees and autumn colored washes. So, yeah, it's pen lines, very I'm cool. assuming, with watercolor. And it's all very gray. Because it is just supposed to, I guess, represent mundane, boring, everyday life. There's lots of just grays and browns with this bright red suitcase. So there you go. The suitcase.
Very interesting.
Yeah, I had a little... I don't often find things in charity shops, but I had a short spate in this one that near my old house, and I managed to pick up that. Then, like 2 weeks later, they had The Now of Brown. So I picked that up.
Have you read that yet?
Yes, I read that. Yeah, I really enjoyed that one as well. It's not quite as short. And
I got that in a discount section at my shop.
Short,
like
fun read right there.
I'd never heard of it when I came across it either. I just literally picked it up in a discount section of a comic shop.
But then after I'd read it, I then saw. Have you got a video on it, for the love of comics?
I've done a video on it.
Yeah. You do it as well, all right. Yeah. And you had seen a couple of people do videos after I'd read it.
Yeah, I made it part of my six comics to reread before I die live stream. It was like one of those books which came to me where I was just like, yeah, that's one I'll get back to at that time.
Yeah, I just changed the thumbnail on mine to make sure it shows the big washing machine on her head. So people.
Yeah, that's a really, I mean, that was one of those books that I read very early on into getting into reading comics again. And then I'd read a whole bunch of stuff that were the big name kind of ones. And then this one I'd read a review of, a very positive review of online. And when I looked at the art, I was like, yeah, okay, I'm going to give this a shot. But when I read it, I was like, wow, that review did not actually get into some of the things. And I think that was a good job on the part of the reviewer not to get into certain things, because it was really cool to discover well, you know what the story is and the character is. But to me, as a reader, that was one of those stories which is like a character who's very different from you, very separate, you know, not at all the same kind of experience. But that's the power of the story, to be able to make you inhabit that person's world for a little while. But yeah, that sounds like a nice charity shop that I would go back to quite often if I were you.
Yeah, it was funny. I found those couple quite close together, and then I didn't find anything else there for ages. And then I went back and I was looking in the children's books section for my little boy, just having a look. And then I noticed just at the top of the children's book section, they'd started to put some graphic novels there. So I picked up in the children's section a copy of Headlopper.
I know what that is. Why would you? I've never bought it.
Interesting.
I was going to say that actually, because when I went into, I usually go into my local Oxfam, which is the kind of charity shop bookshop that I kind of go into, specifically a book charity shop, and they have a section for comic books, but they also have, as you just said, a kids book section. And in the kids book section, they normally keep all the annuals, like the Beano and Dandy annuals and stuff like that. But sometimes they just stuff behind. So I found those Tintin trades recently for like £2 each that were just all stuffed at the back of the annuals. So it's always good to check through the kids section as well, because they don't know what they've got sometimes. They're just like, oh, that's a kid's book. They don't categorize it as comics or...
Yeah.
Cool. You ready for your next one?
Is it me?
Yeah.
All right. Another honorable mention. Well, no. Actually, I have Afterlife with Archie.
With Archie.
Which I think I should leave off the list because it isn't complete. But there's this one volume and then there are some singles and the last couple of issues never came out to finish the second trade, I think. And it's never going to happen now because the creator, the writer of this, Roberto Aguirre, he's become big in the TV and Hollywood stuff with Archie stuff, I guess. So this comic with art by Franco Villa is terrific. It is, I don't know, are you aware of this? There we go. Are you aware of this comic?
Do you know
what it's about?
The series, but I've never actually seen the comic.
Right, so it's a zombie story. So it's zombies in the Archie world. And I think... why I find this to be so fun is because I've, like many people, gotten tired of zombies to a certain extent. There's like an oversaturation. At the same time, there is something very, very fun about the genre when done in interesting, etc. ways. But this twist over here is that it's in Riverdale and it's Archie. And when I read this, I am a big Archie reader from my childhood. Like when I was young, I read a lot of Archie comics, literally hundreds and hundreds of Archie comics. It was just, it was like a weird thing in India. A lot of kids read Archie comics and there were a lot of Archie comics to be found. So you would read them and you'd finish them and then you'd trade them. And when I read this, it's so steeped in the Archie lore that it's a great zombie story and quite a lot of fun to see these characters die in grisly ways one by one. But you could tell that whoever had written it had grown up or had steeped themselves in Archie stuff, which made it a really, really fun read. I mean, more than any other, you know. And I know that Archie's done a lot of interesting stuff, and I tried Archie versus Predator and a couple of other different Archies, and they're all kind of unique, but this one, I think particularly because of the fantastic art, but and the colors, you know, Franco Villa obviously is terrific, and the way that it plays with the Archie mythos and just characters who in the comics might have been like, here's some more of the artwork and the colors. And it works great as a horror story, but I think it works really well as taking that, you know, all-American myth and then taking this other thing. Like, the zombie stuff to me seems to be particularly an American favorite, although Of course, you've had a couple of very cool zombie things come out of other places. The Americans seem to be making a lot of zombie stuff all the time. So to put that American obsession next to that, you know, gee whiz, American small town, all American boy, all, you know, girl next door kind of storyline, was really well done. And the fact that they start with the dog being hit by a car, it's really dark from the very beginning. It's like this dog in Archie that you've read all your life has just been hit by a car and is killed, and Jughead is unhappy, you know, of course he's distraught, and he brings Hot Dog's body, and this is all like right at the beginning, to Sabrina to, you know, resurrect, and that's where all the problems start. And I was just like, this is a great start, it's a fantastic hook, and the rest of the story, you know, continues. So the reason I leave it out is because it isn't done. But I think even if you pick up the first volume and end with the cliffhanger, it still feels like a good zombie romp, because so many zombie movies kind of end on a downer note or a cliffhanger note anyway, that it kind of can fit if you're like all trapped over here and there's a huge horde of zombies coming in. I've seen many zombie movies that end exactly like that. So I think there's, with a little bit of mental gymnastics, you can accept it as a one volume story, but definitely worth a look, not to be, you know, in case people just stay away from it because it says Archie, I think they'd be surprised. But I think if people have been fans of Archie at any point of time or know anything about Archie, it's a lot of fun. It's like really one of the most I've openly laughed and giggled as an adult while reading a comic, which, you know, which says something about it.
I think when you have an attachment to something and it has such a certain feel, when you then see it drastically change, it does have such a huge impact. I remember years ago when I first saw the Family Guy movie, there's an element in that with Elmer Fudd, and he goes along and he gets Bugs Bunny, and he literally just walks across the screen, gets Bugs Bunny, wrings his neck, and then drags him bleeding across the screen. And I was in stitches for about 5 minutes because I just didn't see it coming. Like, it's never happened. He never gets Bugs Bunny. Like, so when they done that in that sequence, and they followed it through to its kind of end kind of thing, I was like, wow, okay. So like I get, like, I haven't read Archie, I know what Archie is, but I get where, like, when they take those loved characters or characters that they would never hurt, and then they literally, you know, kill the dog off in the first couple of pages, how dramatic that would kind of be.
Yeah. Well, I mean, but the thing is that people do it quite cynically, again, you know, people do it quite cheaply, the grim and gritty remake of everything from Red Riding Hood to, it's like this is just a style thing nowadays. So I think to have real substance and to have that, you know, not just here are some favorite characters of yours, but really using those characters' archetypes to
specific
represent
moments, or,
yeah, to, yeah, yeah. And to have that, you know, I think the other thing that has been done really well with Archie, without it being the Archie company, this one is, you know, official, but is in Criminal, in the Last of the Innocent, which you know, Ed Brubaker and Sean Phillips do a fantastic job of taking that dark side of Archie kind of thing in a crime, you know, sort of Postman Always Rings Twice noir sort of way. But that's another similar thing, which I think does a really good job with that idea of what lies underneath the American suburbs or, you know, small towns and things like that. And what is the darkness that's right underneath that? That's another good adaptation and completely unlicensed. This is actually an official Archie comic, but fantastically done. So I think that's another thing that's interesting, you know, where it's not just because, you know, like I've seen Marvel, I've read Marvel Zombies and stuff like that. It's not at the same level because there is a thrill, you know, you get just of that, just of seeing the art of Captain America as a zombie. Or having people, you know, infect and kill each other. That's one thrill. The other thrill is when you do like good storytelling that is sound in the story, but also sound as far as the legacy of the characters it's talking about. So when they give you the
still have all that history and knowledge.
Yeah, it's terrific, you know. And then they'll do new things in which they'll give you the background of this butler and this rich guy's relationship, etc. And then that'll be more of a reference, you know, to maybe Bruce Wayne and Alfred and things like that. This other butler, you know. So this idea, you know, obviously there's a lot of references and things like that always entertain us, but unless they've got their own story, they'll still just come across as just a cheap reference. You know, it'll just be like, oh, it's a gag and nothing else. But I think what this does as well is have that story, have that propulsive, oh my goodness, I'm really worried about them. Who's going to survive? Who's going to die? And it pulls that, you know, it pulls that part of it through good characterization and a little bit of you relying on your history with the characters. But I think it stands alone. That's I think, what sets it apart from something that's just a gag.
That was going to be my question, because I have zero knowledge of Archie, never read an Archie book. And so if I was going into that, do you think I'd still have a good time with it and not feel too much like I was missing out on the gags? Or the references?
Yeah, it's a good question. I mean, I think you'll definitely get more if you are an Archie reader. But I think Archie, in this comic at least, alongside that deep lore kind of stuff, works with what your ideas are. You know, what your ideas of Archie versus, you know, Jughead, the best friend, and, you know, the two girls, and one's a rich brunette and one's the blonde next door. I mean, these are really archetypes nowadays, and we've seen them in sitcom setups or references so often that that's really what it draws a lot of its power from. And I think that part is available to a new reader without that, just because that sense of it already exists. It's kind of like how many people will, I mean, it's not the same level as Superman, but you know how people have a sense of Superman even if they've never read any Superman. It'll be something like that. But yeah, definitely an Archie fan will get a lot out of it. But I don't think it's only for Archie fans, because I read a lot of stuff that when I read it, I enjoy it. But I also say, okay, this only appeals to like hardcore fans like me. This is not going to appeal to anyone else. It's not going to have anything else. And that's fine. You know, they're fan service kind of things only. But this is not. And plus, you know, there isn't really such a thing as fan service for the Archie fans out there. You know, what are these legions of Archie fans you're talking about? So I think that irreverence and the disconnect of the ability to drop it is a big part of it. But of course, I think it's the tension of the story and the art and the fact that it's taking itself very seriously. So you take it seriously, but at the same time, you also know that it's Archie. So that's what I think keeps it at that really fun part of it, where you're not looking at it as a joke, but you are enjoying it. That's the balance that I think is a very difficult balance to strike. I've not really seen it very often. And I think this is one of those examples of where someone has done it, you know, people have done it really, really well.
You said it cut off. Like, did it just stop suddenly, or does the arc end?
The arc ends, but they're, you know, they get out of the frying pan, but they may be in the fire, you know? So the fact is that, so volume one is called, it's called Escape from Riverdale. So it's basically they have to get out of town. So at the end of this story, whoever survives does get out of town, but that's not necessarily safe either.
Yeah.
So,
but you're not just going to end up like a, you know, you're waiting for the next issue and it's just like randomly stopped. There is a point where you can kind of.
Yeah, it's not. I mean, I think the singles that came after this, so this is I guess this is 6 issues. And I think there were 4 issues or 3 issues or maybe even just 2 that came after this, and that stopped. And so that never got collected in a trade. So I think if you continued reading this with the singles, you might find one of those like really absolute cliffhanger drop-offs at all. This one, I think, can at least be seen as the end of a trade and the end of one phase, even though there's obviously more to come.
Cool.
But yeah, Afterlife with Archie.
But you're not mentioning that one. So did you have another one you want to mention? Or
we'll come back to it, you know. It's okay. Just that, because that's the way I did it. I didn't realize that I shouldn't be doing that.
That's all good. Right, so the next book
come for the honorable mentions.
Yeah, I fully expected this.
So I was actually really surprised. I was watching one of the other comic live streams recently, one of the UK kind of streams, I forget what it's called, and they actually mentioned this book, so it reminded me of it, and it's called Lions, Tigers and Bears. And Basically, this has gone through various publishers. The first volume I've got here is by Atlas, and the second volume is by Image. I don't actually know who publishes the third volume, but you can get it in single issues through Image. I've never been able to find a kind of complete trade or anything. But the simple idea here is that there's a young boy who's got various soft toys that he keeps in his bedroom around the kind of corners of his bed to, you know, protect him, if you like. And one night, his imagination, I guess, kind of gets the better of him a little bit. He looks under his covers and he finds this sort of magical world that's alive. And kind of like Toy Story, these soft toys, you know, kind of join him. So you've got these soft kind of plushies that he kind of plays around with, which are just, as I said, kind of toys that he has in his room. But then he places them around his bed. I don't know if you can make that out there, as kind of protectors when he's sleeping. And then, as I said, when he gets into the sort of adventure world, they're full size kind of lions, tigers, and bears, as the name of the book is. So he basically goes on this adventures with the various kind of characters, and they're fun, lighthearted, kind of Disney-esque stories. So the first one here is just him learning to, I guess, get his kind of self-confidence and doing that alongside the bears. And then the second trade is more of a kind of backstory with his family. So someone's trying to take over this sort of mystical world that he's managed to get into. And he ends up having to convince his grandma, which she claims none of this is actually kind of happening, but she's the owner of the toy that is the king bear that's going to, you know, kind of get taken out. And she has to kind of call it back into action, if you like, by having imagination and relearning her childhood, you know, that kind of stuff. So it's really fun. Really kind of animated, fast-paced kind of things. Again, really expressive, like the previous book. And I believe there's only three volumes. Each volume is its own story, but if you were only to read one, you could only really read the first volume, because the second and third ones kind of lead on from the first one. But you could read the first one just kind of by itself. But yeah, it's a book I just kind of stumbled across. It was a comic book closing down sale, I think, 2 or 3 years ago now. And I was literally just going through all the bottom shelves of the stuff in the comic shop, and they were selling these off for maybe £3-4. And I was like, okay, I'll take those. Ended up having to glue one of them back together, but yeah, good fun.
So is it, I mean, do you know that it is a sort of a real world, or are you left wondering if it is a dream, just a dream world?
So the way they kind of hint at it is it's almost like the split between their imagination. So it's almost like it is a dream world, but not necessarily just when you're sleeping. It's almost this whole, in some things I've seen in the past, where like only kids can see something because they've got an active imagination kind of thing, and adults can't. It's kind of more along those lines, where the kid can kind of enter and exit this world whenever he wants, but the adults don't really perceive it at all. That makes sense. Mm. It's kind of hard to describe.
No, that makes sense.
But yeah, it all starts out with his granny basically gives him these three or four soft toys and sort of tells him to put them around our bed to kind of, as I said, to kind of protect him. And then the first time it kind of happens, I'll just see if I can find the kind of pages. He's just kind of looking under his bed covers. If you see the top there, and the kind of world's under his covers. But then when he actually goes in, he actually goes somewhere, like he disappears from his bed. Okay. So I'm presuming it is a literal world, but only kids can access it.
That sounds fun. Yeah.
But yeah, that's it.
Who's the publisher of the second volume?
Image.
Image.
Image, yeah. And see if I can get the The names are on here. So it's written by Mike Bullock and artist is Jack Lawns. But it says here, the front is a little bit of a kind of description. It says, we first discussed setting the sails on the series, this is just a whole intro from themselves. But as they basically, the idea was they wanted to relive their childhood kind of stuff with toys. And they didn't mention Toy Story as a kind of influence, but there is elements of that. But this is not the toys coming to life in their toy size. They're becoming their real selves, if you like. So it's almost like the toys are avatars for the real thing. But yeah, I just thought it was quite fun kind of book, not one that I had come across pre kind of stumbling across it, but it was one that I said one of the other channels mentioned recently, because they managed to pick it up in singles. I believe it's 3 issues a trade if you're picking up individually. And as I said, you can get the first two in trades. I don't know if the third one's ever been collected as a kind of complete thing.
Yeah, I was just having a quick look. It looks like Image did reprint that first volume. It does say volume 3 was released August 2011 by Hermes Press as a full-length graphic novel rather than single issues.
I find it really difficult with some of these older books that I try and pick up. There's a few books that I tried to get that were originally published by CrossGen, and like some of the trades for them, like 4 volumes, 4 different publishers. Like, it's just mental.
Yeah.
Do you have a book to go next?
He's got dozens.
I mean, I'm going to run out. You guys have honorable mentions and a stack.
I've got.
We this came one to play.
I've got this one choice, but then it comes with a. If you've already read this, you might like this. And then I've got an honorable mention. I'll do that last. So my actual choice here is Hilda. Really didn't know of its existence. I've not seen the Netflix show. I didn't know that was a thing. Until earlier this year. And I don't know how many stories there actually are, but you can buy the single stories in paperbacks. These that I've got, there's 2 of these hardback editions out so far from Flying Eye Books. They're like sister company to No Brow. And Flying Eye, they put out a lot of children's picture books, but also sort of all ages graphic novels as well. So this one collects the first 2 stories. This is the book's called Hilda, the Wilderness Stories. And inside is Hilda and the Troll and Hilda and the Midnight Giant. And then the second book, which was out a bit more recently, it's called Hilda, the Trollberg Stories, and it has Hilda and the Bird Parade and Hilda and the Black Hound. And I know they definitely are going to be releasing at least a third one with the next 2 stories in. And I'm assuming if it goes well, they'll just keep going. I don't know how many stories there are. But it's Luke Pearson is the writer and artist. And it's really, it's just sort of gentle, fantasy stories, very sort of cartoony, but cartoony sometimes sounds negative, doesn't it? But it's in a really gorgeous, like detailed way. There's lots to like look at in the backgrounds and in the in all the different animals that they've created, all the different characters. I just found the first story is really quick to read. I just found it like, I don't know what the word is. It's a very calming, just like easy, but almost joyful thing to read. And in the first two stories, she lives with her mum, and this little snow fox with antlers, and they live in the wilderness, and it's really is just sort of about encountering these trolls and giants and all the other characters that are there, and then in the second book, which has the third and fourth stories, the her and her mum move into the city, so it's a little bit of her coming to terms with like leaving the wilderness behind, but then obviously discovering like all the creatures that live in the city instead, and she joins the Girl Scouts, and it's let's see if I can find some. There's lots of. I mean, it's quick because if you look at, I can show this page. There's not a lot of text on there. You're just literally watching her, the Girl Scouts, building things. And then meeting all these like interesting little characters. I knew nothing about it, and I know now that it's really popular, but I've not heard anyone talk about it. It's not something that's come up on anything I've watched. So it was like, yeah.
So I was six of them
it myself. It wasn't someone else was telling me, oh, you need to read this. And it was just really, these books as well are really, really nice hardbacks.
I was going to say, is that like a European kind of almost square format as well?
No, it's not square, but it is bigger than
I just mean like wider than like a...
Yeah, no, it's, I don't think so.
It just looks a little bit wider.
I haven't got an actual... Even though I mostly read trade paperbacks, I don't actually have one here.
Yeah. But it's oversized bigger, though, compared to a trade.
Yeah, it's taller and wider than a trade paperback, these ones.
It might just be with the spine design, it looks a little bit wider.
Yeah, the spine's like a cloth spine, and then it's got sort of some spot gloss and things on the cover. Yeah. It's a really well made book.
I'd say it's about the size of one of those European Franco-Belgian albums. It's a little bit taller and a little bit thinner, but very, very marginally.
Okay.
So Tintin Asterix, Lucky Luke size, but in hardcover.
I like that because when you do those moments like, Rich was showing with the kind of camping sequence with three or four kind of panels kind of silently going across, you have more space to do that across the page if you've got a wider page.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, I think Hilda, with Nobrow, Rich, I don't know, have you ever seen any of Nobrow's mini comics? Like these little stapled zine-looking things almost?
No.
They had a series way back in the day. They had a series, and I forget what the measurements were, what the series was called, 17 by 23 or something like that, whatever the measurements were. And Hilda's, the first story was actually in that. It was part of that series, and it was called Hilda Folk at that time. But yeah, it's interesting that they did blow it up and print it again in these sort of larger sizes after that first volume. So they reprinted the first volume in this larger thing. I think they changed the lettering a little bit, and then a new book every year and a half or 2 years or so.
Yeah, I mean... they've got a lot of in the back of these ones. They've got a lot of sketches and things, and then some sort of almost posters, I guess. And there's a little short story. They're nice, well-made books. How many stories there actually are?
There are six out now. So you had those four that you have, then Hilda and the Stone Forest stuff, the Black Hound, and that's a two-parter, actually. So Stone Forest has a cliffhanger ending, and then you've got the Mountain King. So the Stone Forest and the Mountain King will probably be your third volume for the two-in-ones. Yeah, I get them in the individual volumes. I've seen those two-in-ones. They look really handsome, but...
I commented on one of Luke Pearson's like Instagram posts and asked if there was going to be another one, and he said that they are going to do the third one, I think, next year. So,
right.
Yeah, definitely picking that up. And I will just... Those are some of those books that I will, as I try to convert my children into reading comics, obviously, they're one of the go-to ones that I will start with. Because it's quite Ghibli-esque in the types of creatures that you encounter. Mm-hmm. And especially like in Totoro, where there's the two sisters and they're seeing the sort of sprites and things. There's a lot of that kind of whimsy about it. So, yeah, I really enjoyed that. So that was my official third choice. And then I just want to do this. If you already like Hilda, you might like this kind of thing. And this is just because I recently went to our library for like the first time since I was, I don't know, seven. I don't know when the last time I went was. And I went and found their graphic novel section, which is, again, next to the children's books. But they had the first volume of Stig. I'm holding that wrong. Stig and Tilda? Tildy? And this, it's not quite as, it's slightly more grown up than that. It's not as sort of whimsical, but it was similarly fun, I think, and a quick read. So it's cartoony, not quite as much, you know, detail and stuff going on as there was in Hilda. But this book, it's about these two siblings who, where they come from, when they turn a certain age, it's like a coming of age thing, all the kids that turn this age, there's a kind of legend where they're supposed to go and live on an island for, I think originally it was supposed to be like a year, by themselves, and then when they came back, they were then an adult. But over time, this sort of tradition has turned into all the kids just go for like a kind of spring break party on an island for 2 weeks. So that's what they're supposed to be doing. But of course, their boat goes off course and they end up crashing on an actual deserted island. It almost feels a little predictable for the first sort of third or so, and then there's a slight twist to it with a character they meet that I just didn't see coming. I thought that I'd just sort of mentioned that as an extra. And this again has had follow-ups. I know there's at least another one. This one's called Stick and Tildy Vanishes Island. And it's, again, a no-brow book. And there's at least the next one's called Leader of the Pack. So I don't know any more than that, but I literally picked it up from the library last week and have read it. So I thought that was worth a mention as well.
Nice. Yeah, I had a look at my library recently as well. I posted a picture on Instagram because I was really surprised by the amount of hardcovers and stuff they had in. Like, I was not expecting it at all. There's probably more comics in my local library than in my local bookshop. Which is crazy.
Unfortunately, the selection, we went to the biggest library in the city. We do have a few libraries, but we went to the biggest one. And they had sort of one tall set of shelves that had comics and graphic novels, and then they had another set that was full of manga, and then a spinner rack that was full of manga. And yeah, it wasn't there was a few standouts that I picked up, but there was a lot of just sort of random things. Like there was a, and it might be, you know, some people might have taken out certain volumes. I don't know who's
bothered. Yeah, you get a lot of random volume twos and threes.
Yeah, there was a lot. Like volume three of Lumberjanes, and I was like, I really want to read Lumberjanes, so that'd be perfect, but it's only volume three.
You can normally then go, and if it's like a multi city library, you can order it to your library if it's missing.
Yeah, I've tried doing that with one of the other ones I borrowed. It's called Bird Boy, I think, and there's a sort of a second volume that rounds up the story, and I enjoyed it, but I didn't enjoy it enough to actually go and now buy the book, but I'd still like to finish the story. So I've contacted them, see if they'll order in the second one.
It's a good way to stumble on some stuff though, because like I only managed to get my hands on Oscar Martin's solo volume 2 as a kind of hardcover, and I was searching for about 6 months, maybe more, for volume 1. And to be honest, volume 2 was okay, but it wasn't like the best book in the world, so I was like, if I don't get volume 1, I'm probably going to kind of clear it out. But I ended up actually being able to read volume 1 from my local library. It was nowhere else to be seen, but there's a pristine copy sitting in my local library. So I took it out and read it there.
Yeah, I mean, this... That's been taken out 3 times before me. But one of the other books that I picked up, but I was the first person to take it out, and I don't know how long it's been on the shelf, obviously, but it didn't look like it was a section that was touched that regularly, especially as I had to ask where it was, and I found it.
But the libraries are useful, especially if you are a little bit strapped for cash as well, because you can get them to order books in, and even if it's not books they even have, they'll buy books in, and that could be comics as well. So if you know you can't afford the latest book but you want to check out or something, even hardcovers, like, you'd be surprised what the library will actually do. It'll take a bit of time to get it, but you know, it's free end of the day. Do you have your next books ready?
Is it me?
Or is it me? It's you, right?
Yeah, it is. Yeah, for the love of comic.
All right, so my next comic is what I think is page for page the best value DC comic you can buy. And that is the DC Universe, the stories of Alan Moore, which I think is great that you can have in one volume. And it's packed with stuff, and I think it's great fun. But then I realized that this is an older edition, and the new edition of this trade paperback has taken the Killing Joke out of it, because I guess they want to make money on it separately or something like that, so they're only going to... But this, back in the day, used to have the Killing Joke, but it also had like all these other DCs, these short stories and these minis... that Alan Moore had done, including, you know, For the Man Who Had Everything, which is, you know, a really famous story. And I think it was made into a very well-known episode of the animated Justice League show. But I don't know, because I haven't watched the episode, but the story itself about Superman getting a birthday present, which gives him what he wants, and you know, the trap part of it is sort of a classic story. Then there are
Supergirl show on CW.
Did they do it again in that the thing where Batman and Wonder Woman go to give him a birthday present? Yeah, it's a classic story. It's a short story. It's terrific. It's very, you know, emotional and powerful and things like that. And I remember reading it when I was very young, and it made a very big impression on me. It's just like, wow, what a great little short story to have about Superman's birthday. There's a two-parter Green Arrow story, which is pretty decent. There's a backup story that he wrote, which was a Green Lantern Corps story, which I think went on to create an entire universe. And I think it's a six-page story called Mogo Doesn't Socialize. And it's just a story of the Green Lantern Corps in which it's being told about this guy who went searching for this Green Lantern called Mogo and wanted to defeat him to show that he is the champion. And then it's just a six-page story of what he found on that planet. And from what I hear, the Green Lantern Mogo was later incorporated into stories and things like that. There's There's a vigilante story over here, which isn't that great, and it's one of the weaker stories in there. But then you've got this vigilante story goes on for a while. Then you've got Brief Lives, which is essentially a two-page short story, and this comes across more like a Outer Limits or a Twilight Zone sort of short story, very unconnected to the rest of the DC universe, but it's just out there somewhere with these aliens. Yeah, it's 4 pages. It's got a great setup. It's got a great ending. It's very funny. There's another one of these short stories, which is also a very great setup and a very dark and funny ending. There's a Superman Swamp Thing short story, a crossover short story that Alan Moore had written. And some of these are, these top artists of the day. And then there is Tigers, a short story for the Green Lantern, again, for the Green Lantern Corps, that he gave about the death of Abin-Sur and how it happened and what was prophesied and these planets with these prophecies. And here, I think, if I'm not mistaken, and I haven't read this because I didn't read the big epic thing. Over here, there is one question of how things will end. And there's a prediction given over here. And I think these four panels are the setup for Blackest Night. So Geoff Johns just took this short story and this little bit and that little prediction and made the entire thing of Blackest Night come out of this short story. This short story also has Mogo in it from the other short story. So it's creating this kind of crisscross mythology, but this is before any of these stories were incorporated into the larger universes and larger arcs. They were just these backups. You know, when you're reading the serialized Superman and you'd have a Green Lantern Corps story at the end of it, or you're reading Green Lantern and you have a Green Lantern Corps story at the end of it, it's just a little backup story to fill the pages, and then you get to the next issue, and the next issue the backup doesn't continue. And they're some of the best short stories in the DC universe that I've read, and they were written by Alan Moore. And I remember reading some of these when I was very young, before I knew who Alan Moore was, before I'd read Watchmen or V for Vendetta or anything like that. These were the first Alan Moore stories. And Whatever Happened to the Man of Tomorrow, which was the last Superman story before the John Byrne Man of Steel reboot. And Kurt Swan came back to draw this. And it is the last Superman story, because the continuity was going to be reset after that, so he could do whatever he wanted. And he got this, the most classic Superman artist, to come and draw this last Superman story, in which almost every villain, major villain, comes up and twists and turns and all kinds of things happen. And then it's really dark, because the violence in it and the deaths in it are unlike any other Superman story you've read, especially in this art style, this classic Superman art style, with this incredible tragedy unfolding as the last Superman story takes place. So as you go through this book, it's just one hit and one classic story after another, just collected in a slim little trade paperback. And from this paperback, I can't imagine how many DC stories have sprung up from people who've continued with the ideas or, you know, extended it and all that stuff. But over here, they're not written to be extended universes. They're just like these little, you know. And even with the Green Lantern Corps, I think those are my favorite stories. The Killing Joke, for me, you know, I've discussed this before, hasn't aged as well. But almost all the other stories in this collection get better with time, including the Green Lantern going to appoint a new Green Lantern in this sector, which is completely in darkness. So when he does meet the candidate, he doesn't know how to describe what he's talking about, because both the words green and lantern can't be translated in a universe in which there is no light. So then he's got to come up with, how does he appoint a protector for this sector? And then he ends up calling it the F-sharp bell instead of the Green Lantern, because that's a pleasant sound and that's a tool that makes a sound, and that is something they can relate to. So it's just so inventive, so clever, you know. And way back in the mid 80s, these short stories were kind of expanding the universe and expanding the storytelling capabilities, you know, in the backups. And of course, then there are the prestige stories and, you know, like Whatever Happened to the Man of Tomorrow and The Killing Joke. That so as a mix of like big hits and then small hits that would end up being fantastic stories, I find this volume very hard to beat. It's extremely, extremely fun to read. So especially for, I think, the sci-fi short stories, especially for the Vega and Brief Lives and the Green Lantern core stories, this is, page for page, best, most fun I can have.
I mean, going back to the actual topic of fun and short, I wouldn't have expected you've come with a horror book and you've come with Alan Moore, and the two are not two things that jump into mind when saying fun and short. But you've managed it. I think that's pretty good going.
I think Alan Moore's short fiction gets a little overlooked because he's written so many epics and stuff like that, and because he did it for such a brief period of time. But I think even if you read his shorts, if you read his America's Best Comic Stories, like Tom Strong and League of Extraordinary Gentlemen, he's really good at putting small little things in there. And it's particularly the Tom Strong series, he broke it up like an old-fashioned comic book in which you'd have one long story running, but he'd have short stories and he'd have backup stories and things like that. So yeah, I think he gets overlooked at how good he is at that short fiction. And a lot of his stuff from 2000 AD before he went over to the United States.
I'm going to go on to my next one. Before I do that, I'm going to quickly go through some of the chat because I'm a little bit behind on kind of people. So I think Ruol was saying that it's a great hardcover book. I believe that was the first hardcover you were showing, Richard, at the time.
Yeah, I think that was the Hilda one, wasn't it? Oh, was it? Yeah. I think
it was yeah. And then we've got the Shogun 34, which is perfectly appropriate for my channel, being all samurai stuff, is saying that Welcome. He's from Japan. I'm not going to try and pronounce your name, but thanks for watching. And then this is actually my mum. She's just saying she's joined the chat.
Hello.
So my next book that I'm going to bring up is Outer Darkness. This is one that's by the guys who did Chew. And basically, I haven't been able to get my hands on the second volume of this yet, but there's two volumes of this, and then there's one volume that actually crosses over with Chew, but it is its own story, so you don't have to read it with this or with Chew kind of thing, if that makes sense. The cool thing here is basically everything that's exaggerated in Chew is exaggerated in this, but from a sort of Star Trek sci-fi kind of perspective. So this guy here in the center basically is this somewhat sort of decommissioned captain, which people don't trust and don't want to work with, but he's one of the only guys that will kind of take on certain sort of missions. And it says here, basically, mankind has colonized the galaxy, but during our interstellar travels, we have discovered a horrifying secret in the outer darkness of space. Join Captain Joshua Rigg and the crew of the starship Sharon as they encounter demonic possessions, hauntings, cosmic monsters, and more. So as they basically, this guy is a bit of a, you know, doesn't take any kind of crap from anybody kind of captain, but all the guys on his team are like the extremes of Star Wars and Star Trek. So you've got these sort of people who were like the top of their clan or like the king of their planet or whoever it is that are all like a member of his team. And they all have their own little kind of bickerings and kind of things going on. The art's quite fun. Let's see if I can get something a little bit more kind of character showing. Well, it does have a little bit of a kind of graininess to the coloring. As they basically, it's just a couple of episodes of Star Trek, but a little bit exaggerated. People get killed. There's somewhat kind of godlike egos where, you know, this guy remembers he used to be the ruler of a planet and starts trying to tell people what to do. And I just found it really fun, where there was elements in Chew for me where it gets a little bit repetitive. This just never really had that. There was no sort of rinse and repeat of like I have to eat something, I solve the crime type thing. The only thing that was ongoing is that, you know, nobody was sort of playing nice based on, you know, politics or morals or whatever else. They were only nice to you if they, you know, wanted to or it worked in their favor kind of thing. And there was a lot of backstabbing, and you never really knew who the one was that was trying to screw them all over until the very end. So there's some gory moments, but again, it's not overly graphic.
Is it just that one single trade as well?
There's two volumes. So this one is basically him taking over the ship, if you like, you know, getting the role, finding his team, kind of, he takes them on a mission, and basically takes them to a place where they shouldn't go in order to make them be attacked. His idea is basically, if I put you into a worst case scenario and you survive, then you're the right team for the job. If you don't survive, then you were never the right team for the job. And that's kind of his, like, that's how brutal his kind of mentality is. So he takes them into this dark space and lets the ship get attacked, turns off all the safety systems, and sees if the team can survive. And that's basically the first story. And the second story is then him having to do the mission that he was originally taken on to do, which I haven't read yet. But there's two trades.
Yeah, I heard that it was cancelled, and a lot of people were unhappy about that. So the two trades are all there's going to be.
That's all there is. And as I said, there is the crossover issues if you want a little bit more, but that's not going to be as, you know, main to the story. It's just a little bit of fun. But yeah, it's something that I was quite surprised with. And as I said, compared to Chew, it's shorter. And there's a bit less of that sort of rinse and repeat. So I think you were mentioning a little bit earlier, Rich, with the sort of I Hate Fairyland, where, you know, for some people it would be great, it's a little bit, or it's not as funny if you kind of repeat things. This doesn't really have that. It's its own kind of continuously fun story. And because there's different characters we move to learn about kind of each issue as they kind of do things, we're not repeating like this is this one character's trait or anything like that. And it's six issues in the trade, so it's quite chunky for a trade.
All right. Is that? Oh, that looks pretty nice. I think I actually had the first single issue. I think I randomly won it in some kind of giveaway and I had the first single issue, but I've since passed that on to someone else. But I've never read Chew either, so I have no affinity for the creators or anything.
Yeah, it reads like an animated episode, and I don't say that in a bad way. I like things that have kind of animated expression and the way that they kind of react and kind of various facial expressions and things.
It's John Layman, but it's not Rob Guillory on the art, right? It's someone else.
It is Angshuman, it says at the top here.
Right.
So yeah, as I said, it's a little bit more grainy looking art wise, and I don't know, it's got its own sort of style, but as I said, it's quite expressive and all the characters have their own kind of, you know, body builds and size and ethnicities and kind of that sort of thing. So it's not, you know, 20 of the same people that look the same or anything like that. As I said, I don't really want to spoil anything, but there's various backstabbings and kind of things like that that kind of go on, and people have their own agendas outside of the mission itself. But it's just, it's quite fun compared to, as I said, I've seen Star Trek and various, you know, 100 takes on Star Trek, and normally what happens is, you know, one person kicks up a fuss and the whole team has to kind of solve it or something, whereas in this you could have four people trying to kick up a fuss at the same time, and it's just kind of a bit kind of crazy, so it's good fun.
Good stuff.
Do you have another book?
I have one honourable mention.
Okay.
Which I brought along, and the only reason I'm honourable mentioning it and not actually mentioning it, if that makes sense, is because For the Love of Comics does a much better job of talking about I Killed Adolf Hitler by Jason. You've talked about this book and Jason at length on various videos, so I would urge anybody just to go to For the Love of Comics channel to, if you want to know more. But I mean, essentially it's a sort of sci-fi romance of sorts, and I didn't know anything really going into this. I can't even remember why I picked it up. I think it was probably off the back of one of your videos, and I thought that one seems like the easiest one for me to try first before I try any other Jasons. And it's I've read a couple of books of his since, and this one's my favorite so far. But it is just, it's a really short, slim hardcover. It's some of Jason's work is well, a lot of it's black and white that I've seen anyway, a lot of it. So and this one's in color, which makes it quite nice. But it's quick because there's not a lot to read, as you can see on that page. Mm-hmm. There's some pages with more dialogue. But again, it's quite a quiet yet silly, yet also heartfelt at the same time. I mean, it's really easy to just sit and you will read it through in one go. You will not be needing a bookmark in this one. It's very quick. And you just want to get to the end of it. I really enjoyed that. But yes, for a better recommendation than that, go to For the Love of Comics YouTube channel.
Loads of videos from
mention because really, because you were here.
Well, yeah. I mean, I'm glad you enjoyed it. I think Jason, I've found, is not to everyone's taste. So I'm always interested in, you know, people who've liked Jason or liked one or two works of Jason, because it's not necessarily universal. I was surprised to find out. No, of course not.
No, I mean, I read the next one I read was On the Camino, which is so very different. It pulls apart because this is, you know, time travel, history, romance, sci-fi thing. On the Camino is he goes for a walk. That's essentially what.
Yeah, and it's autobiography, so it's non-fiction.
It almost doesn't. When I was reading it, I almost thought it didn't really matter whether it was fiction or not. It was just kind of this. It was just sort of observations, wasn't it? Just a. Yeah. And then the next one I read was, am I getting the title right? It's one of the collections. It has silent in the title, almost silent.
Almost silent. Yeah, those are all the silent comics. No text at all.
Yeah. And so there was some of those, like in that, just in that collection, I think is quite polarizing. Like just in that one book, there's some things I was reading and I might have laughed, but I might have thought, I wouldn't show that to some of my friends. It's a really very interesting from what I've read so far. Everything has been like so different. But yeah, that was my favorite so far. And it is fun and silly, but it's very short. but it does have a warmth to it when you get to the end that you're kind of not expecting as well.
Yeah, I think that's the part of it that puts it over the edge for me. I think it's very funny and silly and all of that stuff. It's playing with the tricks, but then it just kind of decides that it wants to be a different kind of story. And from one point of time, from when they're keeping watch, you know, from when they're following somebody and just observing him, the book becomes something else and it becomes this much more heartfelt sort of thing. And then it gets to that end. And I always thought that the ending really makes the book. I thought that the last page and the last panel in particular are very, for me, they're very resonant. It needs to be such a slim book because otherwise it would be too much. It's just the perfect length that when you get to the end and you get that last sort of summation of everything, you're just like, well, that's what it comes down to. It's really powerful. So, I mean, for me, that's a big part of why I find it, because there's some of Jason's work that's really silly and really clever, but it's not necessarily getting to the emotional. This book, I mean, there are a couple that really do. I think that the collaboration he has with Fabian Velman, The Island of 100,000 Graves, that's also in color. So if you want the color Jasons, then you go for two or three, because there aren't that many, as you said. But yeah, because of the emotion, I think I put this up there.
Cool. Did you have any other books you want to mention, or are we still on special mentions?
I'm almost falling asleep. I had a couple of books that I wanted to mention. All right, so I've got this one superhero comic, which is the Shazam, the Monster Society of Evil by Jeff Smith. It's written and drawn by Jeff Smith, the creator of Bone. And I think as a standalone superhero story, especially one for kids or all ages, I thought it was great. I thought it was very entertaining. It was a nice modern, and this is before the Shazam movie. So I did wonder a little bit about how would the Billy Batson sort of stuff be in a modern story, you know, because I think a lot of the modern Shazam comics that I had seen only deal with him as an adult or only deal with him in a superhero form. But this one being about this homeless orphan kid, you know, who's trying to like survive on the streets by themselves. And then the Shazam stuff happens is brilliant. And it's very funny. And parts of it feel very much like Bone, you know, where you have just the dialogue going back and forth and the reactions and the expressions on people's faces changing. It's very well done, but it's also a great superhero imagery as far as kids are concerned, or even me as an adult. I think there's a lot of little cheeky references to old Superman stuff thrown in there, but at the end of the day, it's like this really heartfelt adventure story, superheroics Shazam story. It's a Shazam origin story, sort of rebooted, but a standalone story. And I thought it was really, really good. I only picked it up because it was Jeff Smith, and I was just like, I understand it's Shazam, and I'm not that interested, but let's see. It's Jeff Smith, so it must have some value. And I was really surprised at how much I enjoyed it, and I was just like, this is a great superhero story. So this is one of those that I will give to kids or young readers if I want them to read a superhero story. There's like nothing in it to be offended by, but it doesn't shy away from like darker things and, yeah, you know, like cruelties and realities and sadnesses. But it's so triumphant and it's so cheery and it's so heartfelt again that I really consider that one of my favorite superhero comics, which is funny because it's technically an all ages or young readers kind of, not young readers, but, you know, from, I would say from 10 to 15 or something like that.
Hmm. Yeah, it does look a little bit younger than any Shazam stuff that I've read. He's maybe slightly closer to a teenager, but it looks cool. I like it.
Yeah. Well, I mean, yeah, he's a kid. He's a young kid, which is, I think, more towards the original Shazam stories. In the Golden Age, where Billy was a really young kid, not the more...
Read like Captain Marvel, like pre-DC kind of stuff, so I'm not sure what the original is, but the only...
I'm not either, again, from what little I know. Yeah, I'm in the same boat as you. I just have an impression of the things as they were, and I think I've read a couple of those early ones. But really,
I like the idea that you're showing him like on the street though, and then kind of gets adopted kind of thing, or gets like, you know, that kind of thing.
Yeah, that part of it... Yeah, that part of it is there for the first bit of this, you know, which I think really grounds it in something. But it's got that Jeff Smith art style, but just the way that he had Razzle, which was an adult sci-fi story, and the drawings look very much like Jeff Smith drawings. And I haven't read his latest comic yet, Tuki, that's out, but he can do grown-up stuff which has violence and nudity even and things like that with this art style. So I was surprised to see that this kind of eager children's story also could have the weight that he brought into it, because I think it could very easily have been very light, very flimsy, but it's not. I think it's really substantial, and it's really, but at the same time, it's one of those things where you feel like cheering because it kind of culminates in this kind of like, oh, you think things are really bad, and then it comes up. It's just kind of classic superhero storytelling, but done with such intelligence and with such love that I don't find it to be pandering. I don't find it to be, you know, here is just, let's hit these kind of points because that's what a kid's story needs to have. It feels really earned. So I found this to be a very quick read, but a very fun read because it's this colorful superhero story. But again, it's meaty enough for me not to consider it flimsy or dumb. Monster, dope. Monster Society of Evil.
It doesn't seem to be available on Amazon.
No?
No.
Why not? I mean, why don't they keep things like this in print? It's a single volume. It's not a series of, you know, 500. Uh-oh, what happened? My video's gone.
Video dropped out.
Can you still hear me?
I can still hear you, yeah.
What the heck? All right.
Oh, you're back.
Am I back? All right.
Yep.
All right. That's just YouTube telling me to get off and go to bed.
Well, I only had one last book to kind of mention anyway, quickly, before we kind of wrap it up. And this is going to be quite relatively quick. This is 1 week in the library. And what I think is quite interesting with this compared to some of the other books that I've mentioned so far is that the kind of art or the way they kind of play with the medium is different issue to issue. So basically, it's hard to explain. They don't really explain it very well on the back. But basically, you've got this person who's a librarian. He's been a librarian for like X amount of years. And he starts noticing that the books are doing something weird in the library. And each issue is basically the books kind of coming to life in some way and how he kind of interacts with that. And it's done in quite fun ways. They play from everything from sort of silent things to sort of prose sections and just kind of play on the different kind of styles. So we start off with a sort of standard comic and it gives you the day and it just kind of goes through each day as a kind of story. So the first kind of fantastical thing is that he's reading this book and then sort of gets sucked into this kind of story in the book, but it's more of a traditional comic. Then the next story, we have Pinocchio comes out actually into the sort of library and the library starts kind of flooding. And he's got to deal with the kind of wood of Pinocchio and the flooding and stuff that's going on in the library. If he can protect the books and things. There's this issue that starts with the kind of story of the three bears, but then actually goes into prose. So it's literally a sort of 2-3 page prose story and then goes back to him kind of closing the book again at the end. But and then as I said, it keeps going through different ones. So this one here is layouts and charts. So the whole thing goes through all sorts of, there's like mazes and different kind of stuff going on. But the one I enjoyed the most was there's a silent issue. And it starts on Monday and you've got this fly. And the fly flies across until it, you know, gets taken on by the bird. And it's basically like the story of life. You've got, you know, the bird kind of goes along and kind of protects its little kind of birds and things. And then one of the birds gets caught in a spider web. And you've got kind of like Wilbur and the kind of spider web. And then I believe the pig eats the spider and eventually the man eats the pig. So the whole thing goes through the story.
Did you say it was Wilbur? Did Wilbur eat Charlotte?
Yeah, by the looks of things. Yep.
Oh, wow. Talk about putting the dark and gritty twist on things.
And then, as I said, I don't think the fly actually ended up, like, a different fly lands on the book to kind of end the story. But there's literally no words. It's like the story of someone's life, but with the cycle of life kind of going through it. And I just thought it was really cool. And then the last one just goes pretty mental. He's going into different stories. So you have everything from, like, the Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe to the Matrix. With, like, Neo at the bottom there, if you can make him out.
What's Neo doing in the library? Is there like a novelization of the Matrix that was?
So he opens up a book and it's talking about like methods of travel and crossing from borders or something. And I think it just picks up every book that can cross like from a magical world into another. So like the stories of like, you know, are we in the Matrix, or are we in Alice in Wonderland, or are we in the wardrobe? Like, I think it's just all stories that.
Well, yeah, I was just wondering what was the Matrix doing with that collection of books?
I have no idea. And then it ends basically where there's like a torn out page, and he has to try and figure out what kind of happens. So he then follows this story in black and white, and then eventually at the end of his day,
wow,
gets to leave the library. But there's a little bit at the end, which kind of goes a little bit fourth wall breaking, as he notices this section in the book that's got the writer. And then the writer actually proceeds to explain his creativity and what he was thinking of kind of doing. So it kind of goes even further and kind of explains things. And you know, in complete, as they would throw the Matrix and everything in there, because he's breaking the fourth wall and because he's breaking realities and so on and so forth, he has to reference Grant Morrison. And I just thought it was brilliant. Like, it's just so much fun. And then it ends with the end, I guess.
So is that by W. Maxwell Prince, then? I've just Googled it.
Yes.
So he's the guy that obviously is doing, and I've not read Ice Cream Man, but he's the Ice Cream Man guy, isn't he?
Yeah, he's
so,
an Ice Cream Man, and he done, what was the other one called?
He obviously like short stories then, doesn't he?
There's one with like a fish floating above him or something. But yeah, he does kind of weird horror type stuff. There was like Ha 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 he did as well, and a few
right,
other,
that's the one I was trying to think of.
Anthology type things, aren't they?
And as I said, I think there was like a Man in the World or something. I forget. I think there was another one that's kind of similar. But there's two writers that I like. There's him, and there's the guy who did Pop Gun War. And I always get them mixed up because they write similar quirky-esque stories. But Pop Gun War is more like based in his world of stories that writer's telling, whereas these stories are completely, you know, standalone. So One Week in the Library is its own thing. Ha 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 is its own thing. Ice Cream Man is its own kind of thing. But everything he does, he seems to do in a somewhat anthology-esque style. As I said, this is short and concise. I saw it in my, I think it was like a Waterstones or something. It was next to, there was a book called 24 Panels or something like that was funded for supporting artists or something along those lines. And this was just put next to it. I don't know why. I think it just has a similar layout or look to the book. And I've been recommending it ever since because I just think it's a fun play on the medium, and it shows you issue to issue what all the extremes are. You know, you could have a comic that's literally got a panel at the start, a panel at the end, and the whole thing is prose, or you can have the whole thing as art and have no words, or anywhere in between, with charts and graphs and things like, you know, something you might get in like a Mark Kint book or something like that. You know.
Things in Ice Cream Man as well, right? Where he, the form of the structure of the things are things that he's playing with as well.
Yeah, I just think it's so fun in the way it's done. And cool. Even like some of the black and white stuff, you've got things that are color within it. It's every panel, every page is thought out as to how you're going to turn the page to the next. And as I said, it's literally, I think, four, maybe five issues in a complete trade by Image, I think.
Very cool.
Interesting. Yeah.
So that was the last book that I had. We went through a lot of books today, so I'm going to have to probably go back through and tag them all for everybody to know when they kind of start. It's been good fun.
I'm taking mercy on you guys, and I haven't shown the last four books that I had. So, you know.
I mean, if you...
Next
if you
time.
We'll do right
no, no, leave them hanging on. Leave them wanting more. This is volume one, volume two to be printed maybe sometime soon. Let's see.
I mean, yeah, this is a topic we could easily revisit, I think. I think all of us could.
Yeah,
it's cool. Great. I mean, I think we're also quite likely to get off on tangents and go off on discussions, which I really enjoy as well. So I can never feel too bad for not getting to another book because I was like, but the conversation was so fun.
Yeah, that's the thing. Like for me, I always like to allow for both. So that way, if conversation does dull a little bit, you've got enough to keep conversation going. But at the same time, if something sparks right up and you spend an hour chatting about something else, well, that's fine too. Because ultimately, you know, I'm doing this to chat with you guys. It's nice to be able to show stuff to the community and share books and all the rest of it. But the main drive for me is to connect with the community myself. So the conversation's the fun thing.
Yeah, no, and I always have a great time. I know, you know, it's Richard's first time, but I've been here many times before, and I took a little bit of a break because I had other stuff to take care of, and I'm just getting back into the YouTube thing of things. So, you know, when you reached out, I was just like, yes, I've been missing this. It's been nice. Absent for a while because I really do enjoy it. So thanks so much again, you know, for having me on.
Yeah, and same from me. I really enjoyed it. And especially as someone who doesn't do YouTube, so I was expecting a lot more, like me being nervous and fumbling with
you're books. A natural. I think you should do YouTube. Garage, living room garage comics or something like that, you know. I think you've got it.
Just keep the aesthetic, you'll be fine. Yeah,
I mean, maybe if we do like do another one of these in a few months, and then another few months, you'll eventually sort of see this changing behind
evolving over time
as we move.
I think you can see that in my live streams where these pictures like weren't on the back in my first live streams, and the wall grows over time.
Well, I mean, take screenshots from every live stream, and then, you know, put together a little calendar sort of thing. Comic Crack is hanging up, coming on just when we're about to leave. But yes, everybody needs to do YouTube. Richard, I don't know if you've ever seen any of Comic Crack's videos on his channel, or there are
a few. I jumped on a couple of the I'm going to forget names of people now.
The Rambling Chat.
Yeah. So with that.
Oh, that's great.
Yeah, with Sleepy Reader and La Rosa.
Sleepy Reader, that's the name I was looking for. Yeah, Damien. Yeah. I followed him from his channel over there.
Yeah.
Terrific stuff.
Cool. Well, so I'm going to end the live now, just so that we kind of round things up there. We've gone about 2.5 hours. It's been good fun. But so we can carry on chatting behind, unless you guys need to rush off.
I mean, yeah, I will need to go.